Hello, in this video, I'd like to go over some limitations of the primitive recursive functions. If you haven't seen my previous video on the primitive recursive functions, you'll probably want to watch that first, just to get a sense of what we can do with primitive recursive functions, which is essentially everything we can do with an arbitrary computer program, except that all of our loops must be bounded. When we start the loop, we need to have some value in mind for a maximum number of times we're going to go around the loop, whether that loop is an actual for loop in our code, or a loop caused by subroutines calling themselves recursively. This video is about a really neat theorem exactly classifying the limitations of the primitive recursive functions. But to understand it, I need to introduce what are called the hyperoperations. They continue the sequence of functions, starting with addition, multiplication, and exponentiation, where each operation is a repeated application of the previous. First, we define a up arrow b as a to the b. Then we define a double arrow b as b copies of a arrowed together, giving us a power tower, also sometimes called tetration. This function is very naturally a primitive recursive function. If we let f of ab be a double arrow b, then f satisfies the following recurrence. F of a0 is equal to 1, and f of ab plus 1 equals a to the power of f of ab. And these are exactly the kinds of recurrences that define primitive recursive functions. Defining f of b plus 1 in terms of f of b using functions we've already shown to be primitive recursive. And I showed exponentiation to be primitive recursive in this exact way in the previous video. Then we define a triple arrow b as b copies of a double arrowed together. Again, this will be primitive recursive because we just showed that the double arrow operation is primitive recursive, and we can define the triple arrow operation by primitive recursion in terms of the double arrow operation. And then we define a quadruple arrow b similarly, and so on and so forth. All of these specific functions can be defined in terms of the previous using primitive recursion, and so all of these specific functions are going to be primitive recursive. You may be more familiar with the Ackermann function, another way of describing rapidly growing functions. It's defined by these recurrences here. In particular, the first component, m, describes what level of the hyperoperation hierarchy we're looking at, starting all the way at the basic successor operation when m equals 0. When m equals 1, it's 2 plus n plus 3 minus 3. When m equals 2, it's 2 times n plus 3 minus 3. When m equals 3, it's 2 to the power of n plus 3 minus 3. And so on and so forth. In general, it's 2 m minus 2 up arrows n plus 3 minus 3 for arbitrary m. One might wonder why we have these awkward offsets here, and it turns out that this is kind of inevitable when trying to combine successor, addition, multiplication, and exponents together into a single operation. Repeated addition, that is multiplication, works starting with zero and repeatedly adding things to it, while repeated multiplication, that is exponentiation, works by starting with 1 and repeatedly multiplying. So the pattern isn't quite the same here, and you have to somehow account for that. Not to get into the fact that successor is a unary operation, and all of our other operations are binary. Anyway, each of these cases here, each Ackermann function for fixed m, is primitive recursive, since we're defining it in terms of a specific Knuth up arrow operation, specifically the one with m minus 2 up arrows, and we've already shown that those are primitive recursive. But we can also see that each of these is primitive recursive directly if we look at our defining equations. The second two equations define a with the first argument fixed to m plus 1 by primitive recursion. This one here defines the value of that function at 0, And this one here defines the value of that function at n plus 1 in terms of the value of the function at n using only functions we've already shown to be primitive recursive, specifically the Ackermann function with the first argument fixed to m, the previous Ackermann function. So it's kind of a proof by induction. However, the Ackermann function as a whole, as a function of m and n, is not primitive recursive, right? For fixed m, it is primitive recursive. But when we combine all of these functions together, when we have a function a that takes in both an m and an n as inputs, the resulting function is not primitive recursive. Looking back at our equations, there's a bit of a problem here. The third equation defines a of m plus 1 n in terms of a of m n prime for a potentially much larger n prime. If this were a primitive recursive definition, we would have to define a of m plus 1 n in terms of a of m n. And similarly, even though any specific hyperoperation is primitive recursive, we can't take m as an input and calculate the m up arrows operation. And of course, we can calculate all of these functions with a computer. There's just a fundamental need to make use of while loops or some other form of for loops or recursive function calls to somehow go beyond what we can do with just primitive recursive functions. The easiest way to see that the Ackermann function isn't primitive recursive is with the fact that every primitive recursive function is bounded above by some concrete expression using hyperoperations. That is, there's some formula we can write down where we don't say apply the n up arrows operation where n is a variable. We only say things like apply the for up arrows operations. The number of arrows is always going to be some concrete number and not some expression that potentially has some variables in it. Alternately, you could just describe this bounding by saying that our function is bounded above by a of mx for some concrete m, where x is the sum of the inputs. The easiest way to get this bounding above result is with the fact that the computation time of any primitive recursive function is always bounded above by some concrete hyperoperation expression. And that puts a limit on how big of numbers our functions can produce. It takes time to make a number larger. We can prove these two facts in tandem by induction on the construction of our primitive recursive functions. First, you prove it for the basic constant, successor, and projection functions, and then you prove that if these are true for various functions, then they're true for their multivariable compositions and primitive recursions. I won't go into the fiddly details of the proof here, but here's some hints that might make this easier to see. First, if we unwind our primitive recursive functions in terms of nested for loops and the successor operation, right when we talked about having a really robust programming language with addition and multiplication and all sorts of other arithmetic operations, those were all defined in terms of for loops and the successor operation. And so if we unwind our program so that the only way of producing new, larger values is with the successor operation, then we can't produce a value that's larger than the number of steps our program took. So if we can show there's a bound on the computation time, then we can easily show that there's a bound on the output. Second, don't be afraid to round a complicated expression involving hyperoperations up to a simpler one that's obscenely larger. Need an upper bound for 2 times x plus 1? Just jump one level up the hierarchy and look at 2 to the x. It's easier to describe, at least if we have Knuth's up arrow notation, what happens if we compose 2 to the x with itself a bunch of times than it is to compose 2 times x plus 1 with itself a bunch of times. Admittedly, this bound doesn't hold for small values of x, which is why this proof is usually done in terms of the Ackermann function. Right, increasing either argument of the Ackermann function increases the output, and so we don't have to special case handle small values. But anyway, these bounding results tell us that functions like n, n up arrows n, or the Ackermann function are not primitive recursive, even though they are computable. because they make use of hyperoperation functions arbitrarily high up in the hierarchy. Conversely, and this is the really cool result, this time-bounding result is exact, not the value-bounding result. You can do lots of wild things with functions that output just zeros and ones, but every computable function with computation time bounded above by some concrete hyperoperation expression is primitive recursive. To show this, we just write a program in our primitive recursive language that first calculates that upper bound. Concrete hyperoperation expressions are, as we've seen, primitive recursive. Then we set up some sort of representation of a Turing machine in our variables. I've talked about how we can represent Turing machines with just natural numbers before, so I won't go into the gory details. And finally, we run a bounded for loop whose upper bound is the value we calculated previously, the upper bound on the number of steps that the computation takes, updating our representation of the status of our computation until it halts, and then we exit the loop early. So all in all, any practical computer program can be represented as a primitive recursive function. The only computable functions that can't be represented as primitive recursive functions have obscenely large runtimes or don't halt at all for some of their inputs. The primitive recursive functions are a really nice balance between practicality and avoiding issues with the halting problem. Every primitive recursive function always halts, and this is easy to prove since all of our for loops are bounded. But on the other hand, if we have some function that runs in a reasonable amount of time and can't ever go into an infinite loop, we know that it's a primitive recursive function. It's always great to be able to save yourself the headache of having to deal with the halting problem or Gödel's incompleteness theorem or programs that always halt on any input, but you can't prove that they always halt, and so on and so forth. This is one of the reasons I focus my research on finite state automata, which also always halt. So, thanks for watching. In the next video, I want to talk about what we can add to the primitive recursive functions to give them the full power of computation, the full power of Turing machines. I hope that you'll join me next Saturday for that. In the meantime, let me know if you have any questions or comments below, and embrace kindness.